You're listening to the audio production of Moving Mountains by John Eldredge, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author.
Moving Mountains, Praying with Passion, Confidence, and Authority by John Eldredge, read by the author. Chapter 1, Prayer That Works. June 26, 2012 was a simmering summer day in Colorado. Thermometers in Colorado Springs would report a record-breaking high of 101, fueling concerns about a wildfire burning unchecked in the mountains west of town. Fire crews were spread thin, and drought conditions had prepped the hillsides like tinder. Many worried eyes were turned toward the hills that day. And then, as if on some malevolent cue, winds started gusting to 65 miles an hour. A 35-mile-per-hour blast will almost knock you over, to give you some perspective. 65 miles per hour is considered a violent storm on the Beaufort wind scale. Storm winds and flames on dry mountain terrain make for an unholy trinity. The Waldo Canyon fire jumped containment lines. Like the German blitzkrieg racing across Poland in 1939, it began sweeping east toward the city limits, unchecked and ravening. When all was said and done, 18,247 acres and 346 homes would be consumed. I was sitting at my desk that afternoon when a colleague walked in and said, "Have you seen this?" My instinctive reaction was to look to the mountains. Our office windows face west, and I saw the vanguard of the fire cresting the last ridge before town. We'd been following the reports hour to hour. The fire had grown to 4,000 acres and was deemed only 5% contained. My neighborhood, we border the forest, had been placed on evacuation warning twice. For days, we watched a column of smoke rising over the mountains from the fire's epicenter west of us, billowing to a height of 30,000 feet like a thunderhead or the plume of a volcano, all orange and black and foreboding. But the reports kept assuring us that the fire would move north and west and bypass town, so we went on with our lives, until I saw the advancing flames crest the ridge. I grabbed my phone as I walked out the door and called Stacy. "Pack up. I'm headed home." "They haven't given the evacuation notice," she said. "It's coming," I told her. "The fire is coming. I can see it. I'm on my way." Like a man running before an incoming tide, I literally raced the fire home as it swept ridge after ridge. We grabbed the dog and a few belongings. It's true what they say, how little actually matters to you when it comes down to the moment. And we said goodbye to everything else. Our neighbors were the last to leave. They later told us the trees on the hill above our houses were exploding. Stuck in the traffic jams caused by the evacuation, ashes drifting down like snowflakes, we frantically called and texted friends, asking for prayer. My 78 Land Cruiser has no air conditioning, so I soaked a scarf of Stacy's in water and held it to my mouth to prevent smoke inhalation while I made contingency plans should the fire catch up to us. The winds were howling down the mountain now, driving the flames forward like the hounds of hell. We took cover east of town with some dear friends and watched anxiously. It would be three more days of fire and smoke and shrouded hillsides till we heard the news. Our home had been spared. Bits and pieces of story began to trickle in, but it was the reports of the fire crews that left us speechless. A veteran fire chief and a handful of wildfire hotshots had gathered on our street to stand in wonder as they witnessed something they had never seen before. The 100-foot wall of flame should have swept down our summer crisp hillside and engulfed our home in a matter of seconds, but it did not. Every time the advancing fury approached our property line, it wavered, hesitated, and pulled back. The raging furnace would not cross our property line. It would advance and then retreat, advance, then retreat. Though the winds were at its back and the fire had just covered miles in a matter of minutes, we realized it was at that same moment, 3 days earlier, that a friend had texted us. I saw an angel above your house, spreading its wings and flapping them against the wind and the fire. I think you're going to be okay. When we were finally allowed back into the neighborhood, we found that the low-lying grass fire had burned right up to our porch. But the major assault had not crossed our property line. The aspen trees in our yard were still in their summer glory. I know. The story raises some difficulties. It touches the raw nerve of your own longing for rescue and your history of unanswered prayers. Other people were earnestly praying as the fire swept down. How come their homes weren't spared? I don't pretend to know the answer to that. Like you, I have my own story of prayers answered, prayers unanswered, and silence I can't quite make sense of. This is not a story about my prayers at all. What I do know is this. Every day, when I step out my door, I see up on the hill the outline of blackened tree stumps, and then, coming closer, after you cross our property line, green living trees. One side looks like Mordor, the other, Eden, an irrefutable witness to the power of prayer. A disruptive but hopeful truth. Look, let's go ahead and name the elephant in the room. Some prayers work and some prayers don't. Why does that surprise and irritate us? Some diets work, but most don't. No one is really surprised by that. We simply keep looking for the one that will work for us. Some investments produce, others don't. You look for the program that works for you. Some schools are effective, others fail badly. Hopefully you can find the situation that's right for your child. There is a way things work. Can you name anything in life where this isn't so? I damaged my elbow last summer doing some yard work, and then I ignored the problem for weeks until I was forced to see my physical therapist. I went in under the assumption that a couple visits ought to take care of my problem. After all, it was just a strain. It's not like I broke it or something. Yet therapy took months, and I was so irritated by that. And it was irritated at me. That is, I kept irritating the muscle by using my elbow before it was healed. I kept aggravating it because I didn't want to accommodate my lifestyle to account for the realities of a tiny muscle in my left elbow. You know the irritation I speak of. Something adolescent in human nature just doesn't like having to submit to the realities of the world around us and within us. We want to eat whatever we feel like eating, and then we're surprised and dismayed when our health collapses down the road. We want exercise or weight loss to come quickly and easily. We want it to fit neatly into our calendar. We want our friends to be good to us without ever having to look at how our personality impacts them. We want our kids to turn out without making the sacrifices in our parenting style that's required to fit their needs. And so it is with prayer. We just want it to be simple and easy. We want it to go like this. God is loving and powerful. We need His help. So we ask for His help as best we know how. The rest is up to Him. After all, He's God. He can do anything. The problem is, sometimes He comes through. Often He doesn't, and we have no idea for the rhyme or reason why. We lose heart and abandon prayer, and we feel hurt and justified in doing so. We abandon the very treasure God has given us for not losing heart, for moving the mountains in front of us, bringing about the changes we so desperately want to see in our world. The uncomfortable truth is this. That is a very naive view of prayer. On a level with believing that all a marriage needs is love, or that we should base our foreign policy on belief in our fellow man. That simple view of prayer has crushed many a dear soul because it ignores crucial facts. There is a way things work. God is powerful. I ask for help. Now it's up to Him. It reminds me of a scene from the movie Patch Adams. Patch is a young medical student with a heart of gold. He wants to offer health care to the disenfranchised. He rallies a group of like-minded idealists, and they begin to chase their dreams. Then tragedy strikes. Patch's girlfriend is murdered by a schizophrenic man who was among the outcasts they were trying to rescue. The scene then takes us to a clifftop. Patch is standing on the brink. The mood is ominous. It appears he is about to take his life. Patch is arguing with God. I like that part very much. He is reaching out. He is wrestling in the right place. Then he reveals his misunderstanding of the world. Patch is looking up to heaven. Answer me, please. Tell me what you're doing. There is silence. Okay, let's look at the logic. You create man. Man suffers enormous amounts of pain. Man dies. Maybe you should have had just a few more brainstorming sessions prior to creation. You rested on the seventh day. Maybe you should have spent that day on compassion. His understanding is incomplete, dangerously incomplete. It leaves out some awfully essential facts from that story. You create man. Man chooses to rebel against you. We hand our lives, the earth, and the history of the human race over to the evil one. All our misery flows from this fact. But you intervene. You sent your son to redeem us and restore us. Now we find ourselves in an epic war for the human race and the planet. Do you see what a difference those omissions make? You cannot begin to understand something like murder or wildfire without those elements of the story, nor can you understand why some prayers work and others don't. There are answers. Prayer sets up a terrible dilemma for us. We want to pray. It's in our nature. We desperately want to believe that God will come through for us, but then He doesn't seem to. And where does that leave us? I believe God is in the dilemma. I believe He wants us to push through to real answers, solid answers. For one thing, this reality we find ourselves in is far more dynamic than most folks have been led to believe, especially people of faith. Like Patch, we hold dangerously incomplete understandings of our situation, such as, God is all-powerful, He did not intervene, so it must not be His will to intervene. Yes, God is sovereign, and in His sovereignty, He created a world in which the choices of men and angels matter tremendously. He has granted to us the dignity of causation, as Pascal called it. Our choices have enormous consequences. We will have much more to say about this going forward, but prayer is not as simple as, I asked, God didn't come, I guess He doesn't want to. We are embarked on the most exciting story possible, filled with danger, adventure, and wonders. There is nothing more hopeful than the thought that things can be different, that we can move mountains, and we have some role in bringing that change about. Maybe we can begin to find some answers, or at least a new way of looking at things, in a short story from the Old Testament. During the reign of King Ahab, circa 860 BC, the Middle East was leveled by a 3.5-year drought. Crops failed. Famine swept the land. Herds of livestock were put down because there wasn't a wild tuft of grass to keep them alive. It was a scene right out of the 20th century American Dust Bowl, or the more recent famines in Africa. But relief was close at hand. God spoke to the prophet Elijah that the time of the drought had come to an end. After a long time, in the third year, the word of the Lord came to Elijah, "Go and present yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the land." From 1 Kings 18. Finally, the heavens are going to relent. Rain is coming. A real gully washer is headed their way, a genuine biblical deluge, the kind that sinks ox carts up to their axles in mud and gives the kids a week off school. But before it can all happen, and this is the first fascinating wrinkle in the story, Elijah has to pray it will rain. Now, why is that? Why doesn't God simply send the rain? We don't know. We have to stick with the story.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.